Hi, I'm Natalie Beyer here for Underground Mix. I'm at WNUA with Rick O'Dell. We're going to be here for the entire show, interviewing different people, talking with Rick O'Dell, and we have some great music videos coming up for you. And start off the show with some questions with Rick O'Dell. How did you first get interested in radio?
Well, that's a good first question for the first Natalie Beyer show. I was a big radio listener in high school, as I'm sure you are, and that's really when I got kind of hooked on listening to pop music on the radio, top 40 radio. Back when I was in high school, the big stations were WLS and WCFL. These were AM stations before music was big on FM, and so I was a big fan of both of those stations, and I was a real fan of the people who would be hosting shows on those stations. Bob Surratt, Fred Winston, John Landecker, people your parents would know.
Yeah.
And so listening to those people on the air, it sounded to me like a really fun job to have. And so when I went off to college without really any kind of idea about what I wanted to do, I investigated working for the college station at the University of Illinois and went to their open house, got kind of indoctrinated into their program, and got hooked on radio, and 25 years later, I'm still here.
So when you went into radio, did you want to work at a smooth jazz station, or how did you get into where you are now?
The great thing about, or actually the important thing about being in this business is being flexible. You don't often get a chance to play the kind of music that you really like, and so you've got to be open to playing whatever kind of music at whatever station is willing to employ you. So when I was down there, I was playing album rock, even though that wasn't my favorite type of music. But every station you work at in every format is a learning experience, and that's the wonderful thing about working at a variety of different stations with different formats. You get to kind of learn the types of music at each of these places that you wouldn't ordinarily learn about if you're a listener, because you wouldn't hit that position on the dial and you wouldn't spend some time listening to that kind of music. And there wasn't any smooth jazz back then, so I was working for an album rock station, then an adult contemporary station. I've done top 40. I've done country music for a little while. I even did this small station in Elmhurst that was a daytime only station, and they played Broadway music and show tunes. And so I've done the whole spectrum, ending up here at smooth jazz, because smooth jazz came along in 1987 at a station which was an adult contemporary station where I was working at the time. And that's where I got introduced to smooth jazz. And I love the music. It really helps to be working at a radio station where you enjoy the music.
Right. How much control do you have over what you play? Do you have any input, or?
I have two answers for that, because since I'm the music director here, I have a lot of control over what I play. And it's a supreme amount of control over all the music that the station plays.
Oh, wow.
But it doesn't necessarily mean I get to pick and choose everything that I want and program a whole radio station around that.
Mm-hmm.
At this level, the station does a lot of music research, and so we really go out 3 or 4 times every year and scientifically study what the bulk of our audience wants to hear. So then I get to look over that data with my boss, and then between him and me, we get to pick the best mix of songs that we think the greatest number of people in our audience would enjoy listening to. So during the course of my actual shows, I don't get to pick and choose everything I want to play,
mm-hmm.
but in essence, the whole station reflects what we think through research our listeners want to hear.
And what type of music are you interested in, like personally, like at home? What do you listen to?
At home, since I spend about 8 or 9 hours every day listening to music, when I go home, the sound of silence is pretty nice for a while. But when I do listen to music, it's generally smooth jazz or some classic rock and top 40 and sometimes alternative. I'm not a big country fan, not a big opera fan, but it's generally smooth jazz that's in my iPod at home.
Hi, I'm back with Rick O'Dell. And you went to LT, right?
You bet.
What's your favorite memory from high school?
Oh, 4 years of high school, lots of memories. I think the teachers who I enjoyed the most are the people I remember the most, going back through old copies of Tab and looking at the teachers. But it was the friendships that I made with other students who were part of the class of 76 and the great teachers I had that I remember the best.
All right, and you just inducted to the LT Hall of Fame. How does that feel?
It's quite an honor. Never expected it. And I guess I'm living proof that you don't have to be a straight-A student in high school to eventually make it to the Hall of Fame. The 4 years I had there were great. And everything that I've been able to do in my life since then has been built upon something that I learned or an experience I had at LT. So it all fits together real nicely, but I'm tickled to have been elected to the Hall.
And you didn't do radio at LT, right? Or did you?
My main regret about going to Lyons Township was missing out on a chance to work at LT, either the TV station. I don't know if there was one when I was there, but the radio station was huge, and it was one of the best high school stations around back then, still is.
Yeah.
And you guys have a great facility there. I think I'd be a little farther along in my career had I spent my spare time at LT more sensibly working for LTL.
So what are some of the things that you did have to do to get to where you are?
This is really a pay your dues kind of business. And so no matter what your grades are at school or what you did or how much time you spent at the radio station or TV station in college or in high school, you need to have a few breaks along the way to get into a bigger station in a bigger market. So when you leave school and you're out looking for a job in radio or television, what I generally tell people is give yourself some time. Don't be too impatient about where you're headed. It really is, it's like being a baseball player where you spend some time in the minor leagues mm-hmm. first and you pay your dues, and all the time you're learning a little bit more about your trade, and hopefully at some point you're looking for a job will match up at a radio station at a time when they have an opening that's something that you want. So it's good to work hard along the way and not rush things.
And you've had a show for a while. You can totally continue having your show. What do you do to keep things fresh, to keep people listening and interested?
That's the essence of what you do when you're on the air, whether you're on TV or you do a radio show. It's saying the same things in different ways, finding different things to talk about. That really is the core of what we do. And so it's a constant effort and a search, but it's exciting. There's always new music coming out, mm-hmm. new artists. So you get to learn about them, and you get to listen to new music that's coming out, and it's always keeping an eye on what's going on, what people are talking about out there, what your listeners are doing in their lifestyles, and reading a lot of newspapers and magazines.
So have you changed at all with satellite radio? Are you kind of worried, or how is that affecting your job now?
Not worried about it. It divides the pie into smaller slices in terms of an audience. It's like cable TV, what it did to regular television. I think there's room enough and listeners enough for satellite music systems and for terrestrial radio. There's room enough for all of us. We all get a smaller share, but I'm not worried. You can't stop new technology.
Right. What's your favorite part of working here? What do you love the most about being a DJ?
Actually, I love the whole scope of my job. It's not just being a DJ. It's not just sitting at the computer scheduling music. It's not just going out and hosting shows. It's all of those things. And it's the variety. Every day is a little bit different. Sure, you have the same routine. You've got to do a show. You've got to prepare for the show. You've got to prepare commercials, produce commercials and whatnot. But there's just so many different elements of the job that no 2 days are ever alike. Mm-hmm. It's just neat and exciting to come in every morning and know that there are different things that you got to do.
And is it different than working like at a regular office? You know, like people, is it different type? Is it a certain like type of person that has to be a DJ? You know, that kind of like easygoing person who doesn't necessarily have to put on a suit every day? Or
that's a benefit of this job. You don't have to get dressed up. I don't know. I've never had a job in an office, so I don't really know what that's like. Used to work at a hardware store, and being in retail was a valuable experience in that it taught me I didn't want to spend too much time doing mm-hmm. that. I just wasn't good at it.
What are some of your early like memories of music? What like first, you know, what'd you hear that made you go, oh, I want to work with music, or I love this? Or
As a listener, when I was starting out back in high school, I would listen to, as I said, the music radio stations, and it seemed to me that the people who were on the air playing music were having a blast.
Mm-hmm.
And how could you not?
Right.
You sit there for 4 or 5 hours, and at the time I thought that's all you did was spin records, talk about them, throw in a weather forecast every now and then, and that's all you did, and you got to go home after 4 or 5 hours, and that's mm-hmm. it. Since then, I've discovered that there's a little more to the job than that.
Yeah.
But it's wonderful fun. There's a huge fun element to the job, and I couldn't see doing anything else, actually.
What are some of the more work parts of the job that most people who want to be DJ like don't know about? Like, what would you like warn them about, saying, "Oh, it's not all fun and games. You also have to do this or that."
Well, as I said, when I was a listener, I thought that all you had to do was come in for 4 or 5 mm-hmm. hours a day and just play the music that you like to play and then go home. There's more to it than that. Each of us, especially these days in the business, back when I was a listener, they had engineers, so you didn't even have to push your own buttons and start your own music. You didn't have to do any of that stuff. But in this era, you got to do everything. So you've got to be able to stick around after your show and produce commercials and meet with clients and talk to the boss and have your performances critiqued, air checks,
mm-hmm.
and you sit down and you tape your show, you sit down with the boss and have the boss go over it with a fine-tooth comb and tell you what you did wrong or could have done better. So it's a performance job. It's your talent, and so you get to be evaluated in a different way than you would, say, if you were answering the phones or working at a computer.
Mm-hmm. And say somebody stopped you on the street, said, "I want to be a DJ. What should I do?" What advice would you give somebody who was, you know, dead set on becoming a radio DJ?
Hopefully, I've caught them early enough in their life that they're in high school or college still.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would suggest that they spend as much time doing as many different jobs as possible at their radio or television station. Spend a lot of time in your high school and college years and do that rather than if you can avoid going to a broadcasting school. No disrespect toward the broadcasting schools, but if you're in high school or college, it's a wonderful opportunity to take in that part of your education and expose yourself to the business that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I would suggest getting started as early as possible in your life and seeing if you really enjoy the job. I mean, this is one of those jobs that where if you look at it from the outside, it's a lot of fun. It could be a little different once you get in and see exactly what's involved.
Right. And if you had to do anything besides radio, if you couldn't work in radio, what would you do?
When I left LT and went off to school, my parents wanted me to be an engineer or an accountant or a doctor or a lawyer. And I had realized early on in my life that I wouldn't give myself a chance to be successful unless it was something that I really liked.
Mm-hmm.
So, now where was I going with that? What was your question again?
You have to do anything besides radio.
Oh, okay. So my point is, I guess I hadn't really given it much thought. Once I got to college and found a job in radio and found something I really liked, I hadn't even thought about what would happen if this radio thing didn't work out.
All right. And what are the types of people you have in your show? I'm sure you have guests and things. What are some of the, you know, the cool people who come around here? And what's it like meeting them and, meeting the people that you play?
That's the thing about smooth jazz. unlike any of the other music formats, the artists who play and who create smooth jazz are really accessible, and they're nice people. If you go to a smooth jazz show, one of the great things about that is that after the show, generally the musicians will come out, mm-hmm. and they'll spend some time greeting the people in the crowd and signing CDs, and there's a wonderful degree of accessibility to smooth jazz artists that you can't get in any other format of music. So smooth jazz is wonderful in that way. I love, the other thing is, most of these musicians are really down-to-earth people. So when they come by and they visit the station, you know, we take them out to lunch, we'll sit down and we talk on the air about their latest projects. It's just like you and me sitting here talking.
Yeah, It's kind of like a more personal genre of music than the more
definitely
personal ones. Yes. All right. And any last words? Anything like to say to people, your listeners, anybody watching the show, college students, high school students watch the show, any aspiring DJs, any last words for them?
Well, that's a lot of last words. I would say, especially to you and everybody back at LT, enjoy your experience there and spend as much time as you can at the station. I know we went over this before, but you have a spectacular facility there.
Yeah.
It's one of the best. And I have to say, once you leave LT, and if you decide to follow a path in radio or TV, you're going to discover that the first places you go to are not going to be nearly as nice facility-wise as LT. Mm-hmm. So enjoy all the time that you spend at LT and get as much out of it as you can, as you obviously mm-hmm. are.
All right, we have two more videos for you, which I think Mr. Odell is going to introduce for us.
Okay, let's see. Let's begin with Switchfoot. Now, see, back in the day, these guys would probably be at the corral.
Probably.
But anyway, here they are, Switchfoot with Oh Gravity and Reliant K with Must Have Done Something Right.
All right, thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thanks for asking.
Hi, I'm here with Karen Chapin, who's an engineer at Clear Channel. And why don't you tell us about your job? What do you do here?
Well, we do an engineering department. We do a lot of different things. We maintain the computers that not only the salespeople use, but everybody basically is running from computers now. Every song you're hearing on the air is played by a computer. And the system that we use to control in the studios is also computerized. So we do a lot of computers. We have transmitter facilities, at least five or six different on the tall buildings like Sears Tower and John Hancock. We have transmitter facilities. We have an AM transmitter out at 87th and Kedzie. So we have to maintain that. And we build studios, we wire things, we are constantly tweaking and designing and coming up with better ways to keep radio stations on the air and keep the music coming.
So how'd you get into engineering? How'd you get interested in it?
Well, I actually at LT. I was a WLTL alumni, and Mr. Strecker was teaching people about the engineering aspect, and I spent a little time learning from him, and mostly spent time learning about the programming and production ends too. And then I went on to Indiana University, and I started engineering there full-time. I did a little bit of the TV work, and then I worked at the radio station there. And when I say full-time, I mean I went to school full-time, but I also worked there most of the day. Anyway, that's how I got into it, and then I started working for an engineering consultant when I got out of college, and then I'm here.
So if a student was interested in engineering, what would you suggest, like, the path you take to get to where you are?
Study math. There's really no subjects, or a lot of places, schools have programs for, like, you guys are lucky at LT to have a great engineering background place with, is Mr. Strecker still teaching?
Yes, he's
awesome.
There.
He's wonderful. You have math is good to study. Science is good. If you're interested in engineering, I would say find a school then that you can actually work on the equipment and get hands-on knowledge, and just ask questions. There's internships in the city available, and we can, you know, if you're interested in engineering, we'll get you hooked up.
So what's the worst thing you had to do to get, like, to where you are? Like, what are some of the worst, like, scut jobs you've had?
Well, you know, I always say that the worst day in radio is still better than the best day in any other job. So I kind of look at it as a progression to get here. And, you know, you kind of have to do some. When I was working with the engineer consultant, we had to clean out animal poop and some other stuff out of a, you know, they have transmitters out in the middle of a field and stuff. And yeah, no, that was pretty disgusting, but, you know, it's part of the job. It's like you're like a Swiss Army knife, you know. So everything, though, is really exciting and fun because it's never the same from one day to the next. And I think it's such a cool field. So I'm glad you guys are into it.
What's the favorite part of your job?
I like people, and I like music, and I like electronics. So, I mean, like, pretty much I like being able to help bring stuff to people that they enjoy. And I think that's, you know, and also to be behind the scenes, because usually I'm not.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know what goes on back here. So you work, you know, a lot of radio stations here. You have LIT, you have KISS FM, WNUA. What are some of the celebrities that come by? What is your favorite that you've met?
Well, I've met a lot of celebrities through working here, and we have GCI and VAZ, a lot of urban hip-hop stars. I've met Jay-Z. I've met 50 Cent. Me and him were like this. He's great, too, very friendly. I've met Vanessa Carlton, Jesse McCartney, Lionel Richie. But I think my absolute favorite was Stevie Wonder.
Oh, wow.
He is just as cool. I mean, he's a legend, and he's very down to earth, and he's just amazing and kind. And I got to hear him. I got to engineer for him while he was playing back on the air.
Wow.
And you hear, in the headphones, you hear the piano, but you just hear him tapping the keys of the keyboard. Oh, man, it was surreal. It was awesome. Oh, and also we work with Ramsey Lewis, who is another legend.
Yeah.
And he has a morning show on WNUA.
Oh, so, wow.
And I like working with the jocks here, too. It's pretty cool.
And you said before you went to LT, what's your favorite memory from high school, from being at LT?
Working at the radio station. And it wasn't even like work. It was just awesome to just have a place to go and real cool people to hang around with. The teachers were incredible, and just to be able to make friends and have friends that, yeah, I still keep in touch with some people too, and it's really cool.
And you were there during Rockathon.
Yes.
What was that like when you were there?
Oh, you know, that was like the biggest kick to be able to stay up all night and play music. And we were the best rock on the block when I was there. I graduated in 84, and we had a 10-watt, it's basically an exciter. It's the initial stage of a transmitter. So now, you know, I look at the racks at Sears Tower or Hancock, and I go, yeah, that was our whole transmitter, was that little thing. And now we have these big, you know, refrigerator-sized transmitters broadcasting the signal. But still, we were still on the air, playing music, staying up all night. It was really, really, really cool. And raising money.
Yeah, lots of money. So what in music are you interested in? Obviously, you're into a lot of it, but what's your favorite band, favorite genre?
Oh, I like all sorts of music. I like anything from swing to some country, folk, rock, but I'm mostly just a rock and roll. You know, I started out, and people that would even remember that far back would remember Fleetwood Mac was my all-time favorite group. And, you know, I like anybody that makes good music. So I'm in luck working at all these stations. I like smooth jazz. I like dusties. I like everything.
All right, we're going to have a couple of videos for right now. We have The Sweet Escape by Gwen Stefani, and I Will Follow You Into the Dark by Death Cab for Cutie, and we'll be back with Karen after these videos. All right, I'm back with Karen Chapin, and why don't you tell us where we are right now?
This is called our Technical Operations Center, TOC, and this is like the heart of our operation. We have studios on both sides of the floor. And this is central location where we have our equipment that actually, like I was saying, the music is played back from computers, and this is where these computers live. And we also have our computer systems for our salespeople and our business staff upstairs. We have two floors in this building, and part of our engineering department is also the IT department. So we have people that take care of the IT stuff, and we kind of cross-pollinate and do each other's jobs or help out where we need to. So that's why it's so noisy here.
And, okay, now a lot of satellite radios are coming in. People are starting to pay for radio without commercials. How is regular radio stations changing? How are they changing to kind of compete with
Good us? Question. This has been in the works for a while, and we are excited because Clear Channel actually is one of the first stations that has had this new service on the air. It's called HD Radio. I don't know if you've heard anything about it. You do need a special tuner to receive HD Radio, but it's free, and it's available commercial-free, and they have some really cool formats on, like WNUA's HD. If you just tune to WNUA on your HD Radio, and you turn to the second channel on there, you'll hear straight ahead jazz, like the old standards and stuff. Let's see. I should do my homework better. I know KISS has Pride Radio, which is more disco and stuff. LIT has 70s radio. And this is all radio that's available to the public with no fees. All you need is the radio to decode it, and you have, I think it's going to be a good combatant to satellite radio, because you can get in your car and you don't have to remember, did I pay my monthly fee? You just turn on your radio and there it is. So I think that's a great question. I think satellite radio did kind of maybe wake some people in the industry up, but I think that they have a digital format, which is CD quality, they say, and it's something to use to combat satellite or pay for listen radio. So,
and now there's talk of a possible merger between XM and Sirius.
Right, exactly.
Is that
so
worry? Getting, radio at all?
You know, I think one or the other was, you know, there are some people that definitely stopped listening to broadcast radio, but there's just no local heart in it. You can't hear your traffic unless you tune to something like of the 1,000,005 channels until you find the one, you know, that pertains to your local area. So I think there'll always be a niche and a need for broadcast radio for people, because it is local and it's something, it's immediate. And I like listening to the Sirius channels or the what's the other one called?
XM.
Thank you. Channels, because I like to see the scores of the ball games. Like if I'm in Iowa and I can't get something, but you know, everything has its purpose.
It all comes back to broadcast.
Yeah, definitely. I think broadcast is where it's at for a long time.
And are the DJs changing at all? Or are they kind of, you know, becoming more like one-on-one,
you know,
with their audience, more personal?
That's a good question
listeners?
Too. I think that they have reached out more, not only just to keep the one-on-one, because they've always been, you know, local and about interacting with people on the phones or appearances, but they've also gotten into the space age or the internet age, because every DJ is responsible for updating their web page. So when you look at the DJ's web page, you know you're getting something that was handcrafted, put up there, typed in by that jock. So it's like you get a little more personal level with a DJ.
Right.
Than
the
just
DJ
somebody
makes the radio
that's
station.
Yeah, that's on a satellite channel,
right,
that, you know, doesn't know what you like or whatever. And so I think that's a good question.
And if you had to do anything besides this, you couldn't work in radio, what would you do?
Oh my goodness. Oh man, that's a good question. Yeah, I think I'd just go fish somewhere. No, I don't really. I have not even thought maybe something with the music industry, but I really, you know, radio has been in my blood for so long. I don't know what I'd do without it.
And for people interested in working here at Clear Channel, are there, you know, internships here?
Oh, definitely. There's certainly internships available. A lot of the stations like KISS, I know, do a lot of van hits, and they need people to be on their promotions crew. And they can arrange internships with various departments. If you're interested in sales or communications or some other programming, they have internships for all of that. So we should try to get you some information how to get a hold of people. For
all
that.
Right, great. All right. Any last thing you'd like to say to anybody interested in engineering, interested in radio?
Just keep it up. Keep it up, because life is great, and it's the best day, or the worst day in radio is still better than the best day anywhere else.
All right, thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
Hi, I'm here with Ty. He's a DJ here at KISS FM. How did you
be
get
excited? Can you be like, he's a huge DJ.
He's amazing. He's the best DJ ever.
Yeah. Well, I'm not like a
break. Okay. Well, how'd you get into DJing? How'd you get interested in being on the radio?
Well, I started off as a kid just needing money for baseball cards, so I was a dork like that, and I used to always try to get Andre Dawson cards. So I started making tapes with my neighbor, whose dad was in radio, of radio shows, and then we sold them to our friends. It was really stupid, but that's what I did. And then once I got to like college, I wanted to do more, so I went and I just started harassing the local radio station until they finally gave me a job. And then somebody thought I was funny, I guess. No, I just wanted to see if you'd put the microphone back in my face. I was just giving you that time.
All right. So what's your favorite part of the job? What do you like? What's your favorite part of being here?
Well, for instance, right now we're listening. I don't know if we probably can't hear Gwen Stefani through the microphone, but we're listening to Gwen Stefani. I get to talk to her last week, and just it's cool to get to know like the musicians and the artists that you really respect behind the scenes, like as people and what they're doing with their music isn't always the whole story. So that's really the fun part to me. And also, honestly, my favorite thing about radio is being able on a daily basis to affect people, make them laugh, make them cry, make them, you know, participate in something charitable or whatever. That's my favorite thing about this.
So who's the coolest person that you met?
Well, besides you, I think my intern, Karen McFerrin. Yeah. I don't know. I have no idea.
So what would you do if you couldn't do radio, if you couldn't be a DJ, if you couldn't do anything in radio business?
Okay, well, my favorite thing is acting. I do a lot of acting whenever I get a chance to. In fact, I moved here from Los Angeles because that was kind of what I was trying to pursue. But radio is such, I don't even know which one beats it out. You know, a lot of people dream of being an actor, but like being on the radio is such a daily therapy for me that I love it, and I don't know if I could give it up ever. So nothing. I would hope that I can always do radio.
So you took kind of like a non-traditional path to where you got today. What advice would you give people who maybe didn't get involved in radio station in high school or college? How would you tell them to get involved with radio now if they wanted
That's
to?
That's Nina Chantel. I would definitely encourage internships. Absolutely, 100%. I have an intern. Can you get in there and see Karen McFerrin? We won't tell her that she's on. That's intern Karen McFerrin in there. She wants to be the next Oprah, and she will be because she works hard. She's not supposed to be here till 3 every day. She's here at like 2, 1:30 sometimes. She just works hard because she's really passionate about this. So if you really want radio, you should get into an internship with people that you really trust as talented people.
All right, so any last words for your listeners, for people who want to be DJs, for anybody?
Yes. I just found out today that I will be in a bachelor auction on March 31st. I'm very nervous about this, so if you could tell your friends and maybe pool money together, I'd like to make the most money of everyone that's in the auction. It goes to the Lance Armstrong Foundation, though, so it's a great cause.
All right, thank you, everybody. That's Ty, and make sure you bid on him.
Hi, I'm Karen Chapin, if you remember from the last segment, and this is my boss, the Market Director of Engineering, Bob Fukuda.
Hello.
And we're here to introduce, in front of our eye candy wall.
Everything that flashes or makes noise or looks good, it's on this wall.
Because this is what the people see when they walk by, and not the behind-the-scenes stuff which you saw. Big tip. Some of these like control the transmitters remotely, which is basically what you're licensed to do is to operate the transmitter. The emergency alert system,
phone systems,
and then remote.
Satellite receivers.
And satellite receivers. Ding, 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 ding.
Remote gear.
So this is like all the stuff that people that work on this in the stations would need access to. And then the rest of the stuff we lock up in the cookie jar. So we're here to introduce Will Smith, Switch, and then my personal favorite, Smash Mouth. Not the monkeys, Smash Mouth. I'm a believer.
All right, thank you to everybody here at Clear Channel, especially Karen, Rick O'Dell, and Ty. We hope you guys enjoyed the show and the videos we played, and we'll see you next time.